My pleasure. Let me introduce you. We'll begin now, but first I need to do an acknowledgement of country. I would just like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land on which we're meeting. The Gadigal people of the Adelaide Plains, and also pay my respects to elders past, present, and emerging. And just to make this a little bit more personal, I was just talking to Susan before about how we do acknowledgements of country. When I'm teaching design students, in particular talking about sustainability, I point out that we really need to pay close attention to the sustainability of the culture that lasted 50,000 years on this continent. It is with great pleasure that I introduce my colleague, Joana Meroz. Thank you all for coming, and this is actually really exciting for me because I have a history with Joana. We first met in 2007. I think she had just finished her first bachelor's degree at the Rietveld Academy in Amsterdam, and we met in Eindhoven where we were doing a Master of Design at the Design Academy Eindhoven. I immediately recognised Joana as the most critical and perceptive mind in the course, and she eventually graduated cum laude. And famously designed some paper chairs that were designed not to be sat on, but of course this didn't stop someone from actually sitting on the graduation show. Joana then went on to do a research master's at the VU Academy, again graduating cum laude, and then she followed that up with defending her PhD thesis, Transnational Material Politics, Constructions of Dutch Design in 2018. And she's now assistant professor in design cultures at the Vrije Universiteit in Amsterdam. And her research is currently funded by the Amsterdam Sustainability Institute and CLU, the Interfaculty Research Institute for Culture, Cognition, History, and Heritage. If that's a sufficient introduction, Joana, I'll hand it over to you.
Thank you. Can you hear me well? Can you hear me okay?
Yes, I think we can.
Okay, great. Well, I'm going to start sharing my screen. So I cannot see you anymore now. Can you see my screen?
No, it's black.
Not yet. Oh, we can see it now.
Can you see it now, but not when I do? But do you have full view like this?
We can see the like page, back, forward, zoom controls at the top, but it's fairly large.
Let me try again. And like this?
No, it's kind of mostly black with a little white cube in the corner.
Okay.
But this is fine.
Is that okay? Does that work?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's leave it like this then. Good morning and good evening. Thank you very much for the invitation. It's really an honor and a pleasure. And today I'll be discussing some research that I carried out that thinks through the role of environmental factors in configuring design, and it will soon be published in as a Tropic-Proof container exhibition, The Role of Environmental Factors in Configuring Design, a Dutch case study in the edited book Exhibitions and Transnational Exchange, Art and Design, Borders and Boundaries from 1945, edited by Sarah Lichtman, Verity Clarkson, and Harriet Atkinson. So in 1956, art historian Hans Jaffe defended his PhD thesis on the style, in which he examined how the geographical whole of the Netherlands participated in molding the visual characteristics of the group's artistic production. Interestingly, a year earlier, BBC radio broadcast a series of lectures by architectural historian Nicholas Pevsner, entitled The Englishness of English Art, in which Pevsner similarly argued that English art was shaped not only by key individuals, but also by the English landscape and climate. Since then, such environmental determinism, right, so the idea that physical settings causally determine human behavior and hence cultural forms, has been thoroughly discredited by the design history community on account of its implicit cultural essentialism. The problem with this approach is that, as design historian John A. Walker clarifies, it reduces, I quote, a heterogeneous artistic heritage, a complex history of hundreds of years, to a few stylistic and formal characteristics, which are then explained in terms of a set of presumed essential factors of the national culture and the physical environment. Generalizing causal correlations between environmental conditions and cultural forms is a speculative undertaking at best. Yet the overall conclusion that such factors are by definition irrelevant to our understanding of design is too simplistic. Indeed, in recent discussions of culture, scholars across disciplines have been investigating how environmental aspects, broadly defined and including things as temperature, humidity, wind, light, architectural layout, and infrastructures, can play a crucial role in enabling cultural practices to develop into particular forms and to acquire certain meanings in specific places. So, advancing from these insights, this research reassesses whether, and if so, how, environmental factors may play a role in the production, circulation, and interpretation of design, yet without falling prey to determinism, essentialism, or state centrism. And to this end, design exhibitions, in that they come into being at the intersection of materials, physical settings, and processes of symbolic construction, form a particularly suitable unit of analysis. As a case study, this research examines the traveling exhibition Dutch Design for the Public Sector 2 from 1978, in which I'll refer to Dutch Design 2 for short, which was one of the first design exhibitions organized in the context of Dutch post-war cultural diplomacy. It will show how a range of climatic and infrastructural conditions helped shape the idea of Dutch design that this exhibition constructed and disseminated abroad. So for post-war cultural diplomacy to work, culture had to travel abroad. This may seem obvious, but it proved to be a challenge for the Dutch government in the case of material culture. To begin with, for much of Dutch history, the state had distanced itself from cultural promotion, considering this to be chiefly civil society's concern. This attitude started changing after the Second World War, when the government began to view an active cultural politics as necessary to promote goodwill towards the Netherlands abroad. In the context of the Cold War, moreover, the government started regarding international cultural exchange as essential to reducing tension and conflict among nations. Accordingly, the Dutch government started participating more actively in organizing and financing international cultural activities, as evidenced by its signing of bilateral cultural agreements. So these agreements, which specify the cultural exchange between two countries, became one of the most widespread instruments of post-war cultural diplomacy worldwide. In 1946, the Netherlands signed its first agreement with Belgium, but by 1970, the number had increased to around 22. Their proliferation prompted the government finally to formalize its involvement with international cultural exchanges in 1970. However, such agreements caused logistical, financial, and material difficulties for the Dutch government. Advancing from a 19th century understanding of culture as high culture, countries often requested exhibitions of paintings by renowned Dutch 17th century masters, such as Rembrandt and Vermeer. The limited number of such artworks restricted the number of cultural exchanges that the Netherlands could provide at any one point in time, while the costs involved in sending masterpieces abroad was exorbitant. According to international agreements, the sending country was expected to bear the costs for insurance and the international transport of exhibitions, And given the value of such pieces, these added up to substantial sums. Masterpieces' fragility furthermore meant that they often could not withstand long distance travel or the environmental conditions of the institutions in many host countries, thereby also limiting the geographical reach of Dutch soft power. Indeed, recurrent exposure to light and vibration, as well as variations in temperature and humidity, damage the artworks. So, to preserve their physical integrity abroad meant undertaking potentially expensive measures. So, for example, to ensure appropriate acclimatization of a 1978 exhibition of original Rembrandt etchings in Indonesia, it was necessary to install no fewer than 15 air conditioners in the gallery where they were shown. So in sum, to be a useful tool of soft power, an artifact had to be able to withstand material degradation while being exposed to different and changing environmental conditions. These restrictions greatly constrained the authorities responsible for Dutch cultural diplomacy in the instrumentalization of the visual and applied arts. In the course of the 1960s, UNESCO broadened the narrow definition of culture to a more anthropological and democratic one that included civilization as a whole. Accordingly, the Dutch government adjusted its own definition of national culture to include, I quote, in addition to the arts and sciences, a greater variety of expressions of our people than in the past, end quote. Adopting this broader understanding enhanced Dutch cultural diplomacy, since it greatly increased the domestic cultural supply. Crucially, it also allowed those responsible for organizing and implementing Dutch cultural exchange to leave the masterpieces at home while developing different circulating exhibition programs that included other types of artifacts with material properties better suited to long-distance travel and foreign environmental conditions. Given the restrictions and requirements that material and environmental conditions imposed on the mobilization of Dutch culture, since the 1970s, exhibitions meant for international cultural exchange started including design as an alternative yet attractive substitute for masterpieces. As the minutes of the meetings of the Dutch committees responsible for coordinating and organizing the international exchange of fine and applied arts exhibitions at the time reveal, they deemed design artifacts' material properties to be more compatible with foreign environmental conditions than conventionally defined forms of culture. Accordingly, the committee started developing new exhibition strategies that included design instead of oil paintings and antique applied arts. One strategy was to switch the focus of exhibitions from works by great masters to thematic exhibitions, and hence from original masterpieces to realia. Doing so was certainly part of a wider historical shift towards social history and everyday life. But this approach also dovetailed with the Dutch government's material need for a broader understanding of culture that included sturdier and more cost-effective artifacts. Another strategy was to send documentary exhibitions augmented by original yet relatively inexpensive works, such as models or furniture pieces, with the idea that they would make the exhibitions more interesting. The final strategy was to focus on design rather than art. So, for example, the Dutch government agreed to celebrate 200 years of diplomatic relations with the United States of America in 1982. Through a retrospective exhibition on the style, with the provision that, quote, the focus would be on the design aspect, such as architectural drawings, furniture, and applied arts, end quote. So design exhibitions, in that they were relatively cheaper to transport and to insure, they were lightweight and compact, durable and portable, could be described as having the material property of plasticity, Plasticity means that design exhibitions were more amenable to long distance travel and more compatible with a range of different environmental conditions than conventionally defined forms of culture. Design exhibitions therefore emerged as highly advantageous for Dutch post-war cultural diplomacy, since they enabled the mobilization and preservation of national culture in more diverse locations. They thus permitted the enactment of a more financially viable, geographically extensive, and physically reliable type of post-war soft power cultural diplomacy, which I describe as plastic diplomacy. So far, I have considered how design exhibitions became a useful form of Dutch cultural diplomacy, given their plasticity. To understand how environmental conditions furthermore contributed to defining the specific types of design that could be exhibited abroad, the places they could be circulated to, and hence also the types of narratives about Dutch design that these exhibitions could tell, I will now examine the specific case of the internationally traveling exhibition Dutch Design 1, which was the prequel to Dutch Design 2. In the early 1970s, the organ responsible for coordinating international exhibitions in the field of design within the framework of Dutch international diplomacy received a request from the Louisiana Museum of Modern Art in Denmark for an exhibition on Dutch public design. The committee offered to organize it as part of their country's bilateral cultural treaty. To this end, it appointed a small curating team and Gert Dunbar as designer of the exhibition Dutch Design for the Public Sector One, or Dutch Design One, as I'll refer to it. Dunbar was at the time a partner at Tel Design, one of the main design agencies in the Netherlands during the 1960s, known for its informal approach and expressive tongue-in-cheek designs that made serious governmental and large-scale private companies appear more friendly and accessible to the public. The house tile that Tel Design designed for the Dutch railways in 1968, with its controversially cheerful chrome yellow trains, dynamic logo, and compelling wayfinding system and pictograms, perfectly exemplified the Bureau's design attitude. In 1977, Dunbar left the company to establish Studio Dunbar, which gained international acclaim for its many large-scale projects, such as the house tile for the Dutch police. So what was the meaning of public design in that context? Well, public design generally refers to products that serve the needs of people in public space. The term can, however, be interpreted in both a broad and a narrow sense. The broad understanding of public design refers to citizens' own interventions in public space to address their perceived needs, such as the construction of playgrounds in the city where lacking. In contrast, the narrow understanding denotes the products commissioned by semi-governmental organizations from professional designers to be used in public services and amenities, such as street signs and benches, train timetables and carriages, stamps and banknotes. Since the exhibition Dutch Design 1 was initially only expected to tour within Europe and therefore not to incur substantial transportation costs, the curators had leeway to develop a rather voluminous and comprehensive exhibition that represented both understandings of public design. Accordingly, Dutch Design 1 included several examples of design implemented by public service companies, right? The narrow understanding of public design, such as a full-size clock commissioned by the Dutch railways. But the curators were also explicitly critical of the gaps in the government's design policies. The exhibition, therefore, also included many examples of citizen interventions that attempted to redress government inaction vis-a-vis public services and public spaces and services, right? The broad definition, such as a full-size white car, which was a pioneering free car sharing project that aimed to reduce urban traffic congestion caused by private automobiles. And you can see that actually here, this white car was traveling as part of the exhibition. After opening at Louisiana in 1973, Dutch Design One toured Europe for nearly 4 years. But at the same time that Dunbar was working for this exhibition, he started making plans for a sequel to open in Indonesia. Dunbar had personal and professional ties with that country, as he had been born there and had maintained close contacts with the Art Academy in Bandung. The rapprochement with Indonesia through cultural exchange was a priority for the Dutch government at that time. Dutch-Indonesian cultural relations had a strained history given the centuries of colonial interactions. The Dutch establishment of the United East Indies Company, VOC, in 1602, and its trade monopoly in the territory that is now Indonesia, the Dutch colonization of those territories as the Dutch East Indies, Indonesia's bitter struggle for independence from the Netherlands between 1945 and 1949, and Indonesia's severing of all diplomatic relations between the two countries in 1956. The restoration of these ties in 1968 was accompanied by the establishment of a bilateral cultural agreement that same year. The diplomatic context was therefore very receptive to Dunbar's plan, and the committee advising the implementation of Dutch-Indonesian cultural relations agreed to support its development into an international traveling exhibition that would premiere in Indonesia and that could subsequently be used to fulfill other Dutch bilateral cultural agreements. Given the material and financial costs of transporting an exhibition to Indonesia and beyond, the agreement specified that the Netherlands would be offering Indonesia a simpler and limited version of Dutch Design One. A different curating team was appointed, again with Dunbar as exhibition designer. Their brief specified the design of a flexible yet sturdy exhibition that was adaptable to the physical, financial, climatic, infrastructural, and logistical constraints imposed by frequent international transport to yet to be determined destinations, starting with Indonesia, for a duration of about 4 years. Creating a design exhibition that maximized the mobility of Dutch culture while minimizing its deterioration during its tour can be viewed as a clear example of plastic diplomacy. Dunbar accommodated this set of requirements by amplifying the plasticity of the design, both in and of the exhibition, which is to say, by working with the properties of compactness, lightness, robustness, versatility, resilience, affordability, and disposability to maximum effect. For instance, to reduce packaging and the necessity of paying for storage, Dunbar designed the display as folding screens that fit into crates, while the crates themselves were used as part of the display. To make the exhibition adaptable to different still unknown places, Dunbar also designed the display as a simple, light, intuitive, and collapsible modular system that could easily be put together by locals, thereby dispensing with the need to send along an expensive Dutch supervisor. And here's a manual that Dunbar designed to assist locals in setting up the exhibition unattended. To withstand the climatic conditions of Indonesia and of any other country the exhibition might travel to, the display design made extensive use of clear perspex sandwich frames to encase and protect the artifacts on show from humidity. for the display panels, Dunbar even developed a new composite material of plastic and aluminium that was compact, light, fire resistant, sturdy, and most significantly, as he described it, tropic-proof, which is to say impervious to sweltering tropical conditions. And these turned out to be sensible measures. Indeed, they ensured that Dutch Design 2 emerged unscathed after spending several weeks in its crates under the baking sun in an Indonesian port before being cleared by customs authorities. On a communication level, it was necessary for the exhibition both to preserve and to convey its own character, irrespective of the specificities of the settings where it would be shown. This entailed creating a strong and clearly recognizable visual identity that would stand out from different surroundings as well as to withstand them. Dunbar tackled this problem through the systematic use of striking colors and physical elements, such as the recurrent use of red accents and large wing nuts. On the other hand, the necessity of conveying the exhibition's distinctiveness and message to a wide and diverse audience of various cultural and linguistic backgrounds imposed the opposite requirement, that it be polysemic, so relatively open to interpretation. To this end, Dunbar emphasized direct sensory rather than verbal communication by keeping captions to a minimum and by making the display design visually stimulating, open, and inviting to the public to touch and use the material on show. And this is, for example, Dunbar hung booklets from chains in front of the exhibition display to encourage visitors to leaf through them. One of the anticipated consequences of this interactive format was the wear and tear of the products on display, necessitating their periodic substitution. Nevertheless, replacing railway timetables, telephone books, and stamps, which were, after all, mass-produced, inexpensive, lightweight, and compact, was relatively cheap and easy. In sum, the amplification of the exhibition's plasticity guaranteed the integrity of Dutch culture as it toured abroad, not only by protecting it from the elements, but also by deliberately factoring in the necessity of regularly updating it by making use of resilient yet disposable content. But how did such practical considerations impact the narrative of Dutch public design that the exhibition could construct and circulate abroad? The curators of Dutch Design 1 were able to present a comprehensive narrative that encompassed both narrow and broad understandings of public design because the volume, weight, and climatic stipulations of European travel permitted the inclusion of a wide range of examples of design objects. However, the physical constraints of long-distance travel and the Indonesian environment meant that Dutch Design 2 needed to be much smaller than its predecessor, and so its content had to be substantially pared down. Thus, while Dutch Design 1 had included bulky artifacts, such as a full-sized white car, Dunbar had to trim the exhibition content down to largely two-dimensional artifacts that could be folded neatly into crates, which fitted into transportation containers. And it is for this reason that the curators often refer to Dutch Design 2 as the container exhibition. It also meant that the curators had to adjust the exhibition's narrative of Dutch public design into one that could be supported by fewer artifacts and predominantly of one specific type of artifact, graphic design. Correspondingly, they pruned Dutch Design 1's comprehensive narrative to include only the narrow definition of public design. To recap, products from professional designers commissioned by governmental organizations to be used in public services and amenities. So consequently, Dutch Design 2 came to showcase graphic design by four Dutch public service providers renowned for their design policies at the time: the Dutch Railways, the Dutch Postal and Telecommunications Service, the State Printing and Publishing Office, and the Dutch Bank. The curators were concerned, however, that their adherence to the narrow understanding of public design would invite criticism, as this narrow definition inherently refers to products of the state for the implementation of state policies. It could quite easily be associated with a propagandist totalitarian state's control of cultural production. Yet this is exactly the opposite of the message that the curators aim to convey. Indeed, one of their main goals was for the exhibition to show to the world that, I quote, "democracy in art needn't be an alibi for a dictatorship," end quote. Therefore, the curators proposed a specific interpretation of the exhibition's state-sponsored public design that I would like to call humane modernism. So what is humane modernism? The curators viewed public design's most important function as mediating the communication between service providers and the public by visually and tangibly formulating messages so that the public could easily understand them. Therefore, the curators maintained, clarity ought to be one of public design's indispensable and overarching principles. However, although the curators thereby subscribed to modernist principles of functionality and clarity, they nevertheless reasoned that those qualities were not the only ones necessary for public design to perform adequately. To this end, they argued, pleasure, surprise, and creativity were also crucial. Indeed, the curators held that, quote, interesting shapes, intriguing shapes, pleasant, funny, or even beautiful shapes, unquote, actually enhance design's functionality by breaking visual repetition and automatism, and by seducing viewers to look at the information provided with heightened interest and curiosity. Accordingly, the curators were interested in projects that were neither anti-modernist nor postmodern, but that instead explored a gentle inflection of modernism by combining clarity with humor, rationality with pleasure, company requirements and user needs, all of which can aptly be described as humane modernism. So examples of humane modernist designs featured in Dutch Design 2 included the wayfinding system implemented by the City Hall in Hoorn, where expressive and narrative photography of two people performing a variety of actions was used to show the way. Banknotes with special purpose tactile recognition aids for the blind. And a hospital wayfinding system composed of the illustration of a brightly colored ball comically bouncing off the other institutional signage. Hence, while the exhibition's title, Dutch Design for the Public Sector, implied that the exhibition was a faithful representation of public design as it was generally implemented in the Netherlands, it in fact showcased only one specific approach to public design in that country: humane modernism. Dutch Design 2 toured locations in the Netherlands, Indonesia, the United States of America, Canada, and the United Kingdom, among others, until around 1985. As an international traveling exhibition operating as cultural diplomacy, Dutch Design 2 was intended to communicate a particular narrative of national culture abroad. Yet, as we have seen, This was not simply an arbitrary symbolic construction by curatorial intentions, design strategies, and political agendas. Instead, the exhibition emerged as a constellation of specific materials, artifacts, and narratives pieced together solutions to the physical difficulties of moving and preserving Dutch culture abroad. Indeed, besides being shaped by cultural diplomatic imperatives, the exhibition and its articulation of Dutch design were also the literal products of environmental circumstances. Tropical conditions that required the use of plastic and new composite materials in the display design, financial limitations that encouraged the selection of replaceable and affordable mass-produced artifacts, and container restrictions that motivated a narrative of Dutch public design as humane modern graphic design. So to conclude, neither the design brief nor all the design solutions offered in the case of Dutch Design 2 are unique. To be sure, factors such as weight, dimensions, and climatic conditions have been standard concerns in the design featured in and of internationally traveling design exhibitions. However, what is distinctive about the study and what makes it relevant beyond this particular case is its reappraisal of the relevance of environmental factors and how exhibitions participate in the construction, circulation, and interpretation of design. While recent scholarship on national design has tended to leave environmental circumstances out of consideration, this study demonstrates that such conditions actually can play influential, if unexpected, roles in these dynamics. For example, it has shown that environmental factors do not causally determine, but in interaction with artifact-specific material characteristics, allow or disallow artifacts to be construed in particular forms and in particular places. Moreover, while traditional histories of national design have tended to discuss the environment as if it coincided with territorial borders, this study has illustrated that environmental conditions can also act upon design on a transnational scale. These points are important, if evident, because they imply that accounting for such circumstances in our investigations does not necessarily lead to determinism, essentialism, or state centrism. On the contrary, precisely because environmental factors operate at different levels, their examination offers a powerful means of escaping reductive interpretations. While a thorough reconceptualization of environmental circumstances, their meanings, functions, and our approaches to them in relation to design is therefore in order, this brief study has yielded some theoretical and methodological considerations that might serve as starting points to this end. Traditional histories of national design can be said to have taken an idealist stance by deciding in advance what the relevant environmental factors are and how they affect design. By contrast, an empirical approach such as the one I have pursued here can help avoid these pitfalls. It entails suspending predetermined notions about what counts as environmental aspects, and instead allowing a case's empirical material to reveal which particular idiosyncratic and unexpected circumstances happen to have had an impact on the constitution of design in particular ways. As such, while the term environment seems to imply a view of the world as separate from and external to humans, the empirical approach advocated here, in fact, also challenges the researcher to suspend any automatic dualism to identify how the relationship between humans, design, and the world is conceptualized, each case anew. This means that, on a theoretical level, Such an empirical approach entails refraining from attempting to come to any definitive, fixed, and ahistorical definition of environmental factors, and instead view their meaning as variable and contingent to the case at hand. Thank you.
Thank you, Joana. I think we should open it up for questions. Does anyone want to kick it off?
I'll go. Hello, Joana. Thank you very much for that. We had somebody here a couple of weeks ago talking about the Venice Biennale, where, of course, people spent, or government spent a huge fortune sending over very large exhibitions. So it's actually a beautiful counterpoint to see an example of an international exhibition that tries not to impose itself or be such a big statement and is really sensitive to those issues. Now, apologies, I'm not a designer, so my question will probably reveal that, but you captured beautifully how the environmental factors led to the focus on graphic design and the way in which the packaging lent itself to two-dimensional, hence graphic design. But I was wondering, and this would be a chicken and egg problem, but I was interested to know, and one of your final slides referred to design for the public service, for public institutions. Were there other forms of design that were quite strong, high profile in the Netherlands at the time that didn't get featured in this because they couldn't travel? I'm thinking especially of domestic design. Or was this a function of the fact that it just wasn't particularly strong, or was it something that was precluded from being part of the featuring of the design that was featured because things that are made for the public space of, for example, public transportation systems have to be made in a fairly robust way so they can withstand, they have the plasticity that means they can travel. Were there things closed off, I suppose, that couldn't travel within the design context because of these requirements?
Thank you for this question. Yes. So in 1989, the new organ that was responsible for organizing in the international cultural exchange in the Netherlands decided that it was time to make another blockbuster exhibition like this one had been. So they said, let's do this in an updated version. And for a variety of reasons that also have to do with the development of the discourse and thinking of design in the Netherlands in the 1980s. So a really very strong focus on anonymous design, more anonymous design, industrial design, material culture, you know, so that focus became much more present in the discourse, in museums, in history. So that fed into this organ in responsible for international cultural exchanges to want to create a blockbuster exhibition on anonymous design, industrial design, everyday material culture. And I looked at the archives, at the full archives of the development of the exhibition. And in the beginning, they wanted to focus on, for example, the Dutch company specialized in waterworks drilling. And they had a massive drill that, for example, was supposed to be included in the exhibition. They wanted to include DAF, the trucks, these Dutch huge trucks, KLM airplanes. I mean, like, and this was supposed to travel to New York. And they wanted to show not only the Dutch industrial kind of everyday products, but also the Dutch understanding of design, which at the time, you know, here in the Netherlands, they were seen as being quite progressive for having a kind of non-iconic understanding of design. So they wanted to both showcase these Dutch industrial everyday products and their progressive Dutch understanding of design. But this was completely undoable. I mean, things would not fit into the door of the museum. I don't know how to pronounce it, the Cooper Hewitt Museum. I don't know how to pronounce it in English, but it would literally not fit through the building. So there was a process again of paring down and down and down and down, in which the ultimate exhibition showcased jewelry, vases, interior products, like one off very, you know, kind of studio design pieces. And it was called Rietveld's Hairs, right? So it was really put into this modernist lineage, you know, and the narrative again became, it was quite different, a different narrative from this one, but it was very much about fitting. So it was about fitting the products into the environments and the transportation and so on. And again, reshaping the narrative in such a way that it would accommodate the products that could be circulated. And that exhibition that ended up circulating as Rietveld's Hairs in this kind of miniaturized fashion was a kind of summary of a very large scale exhibition that had taken place in the Netherlands, where these products were shown in the gardens of the museums. So also here, they could not be shown indoors, but okay, I don't know, you know, here it was possible because of other considerations to just park these things outside of the museum and still show them as part of design discourse rather than being seen in everyday life, right? So this was a way to, on the one hand, frame those everyday objects as, you know, part of design discourse, but on the other hand, it was a halfway solution in a way. So I don't know if this answers your question.
No, it absolutely does. And you flagged that. I don't know if this is your area or not, but how much of the decision-making was around the feasibility of moving the actual items materially and displaying them, and how much was about government's narratives around how they want to present themselves in the world? Because the vision, as you said, of the Netherlands in the progressive, the examples you showed was a very modern, inclusive, country as a vision of the Netherlands to put out there, but having big giant drill bits and that large industrial machinery sounds like it's a very different kind of narrative that somebody wanted to get across. Was that a governmental kind of pressure?
This was a question that I could never get a very straight answer to. There was something about for sure, a more commercial approach, absolutely, in the 1990s. So it was, I suppose, on the one hand, trying to display design scholarship in the Netherlands as a kind of social history approach to design in the 1980s, and very adamantly so. So not in the fringes, but mainstream. So on the one hand, because these committees here are always composed by many different, you know, representative of all sorts of institutions. So this, even though it is a governmental organ, you can say it's top down. These governmental organs always need to have like a broad support by all sorts of different actors, you know, museums, universities, and so on. So there was this design scholarship approach to social history that therefore this governmental organ accepted. But there was also a shift in international cultural policy in the 1980s in the Netherlands, which said, well, very well to have represented the Netherlands as this progressive country in the 1970s with, for example, this exhibition. But now culture needs to start paying for itself in the 1980s. So there was a shift in international cultural policy indeed to embrace a commercial approach, right, to culture. So this exhibition in the 1990s, Rietveld's Heirs, in a way, again, there was this kind of dovetailing of an understanding of design from a social history approach and promoting those everyday industrial artifacts in a commercial, with a commercial intention indeed. So this, so yes, it was it was a way, it was not a consensus, that's the thing. It was something that ended up matching the restrictions with the necessity of creating this kind of broad base. So everybody had to agree on what would be shown for different reasons. And then together with these environmental and physical restrictions, then this, that's what the exhibition turned out in. So I hope, yeah, so, I mean, to come back to your, I think your question, it was a very different narrative, absolutely, of Dutch design, but there were similar kind of dynamics at play, even though the result was different.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that.
Thanks for that. And in some ways, your last answer has kind of answered my question that I was going to make to some extent. I was going to say that I felt like you were setting up a real kind of absolutist distinction between essentialism or idealism on the one hand, i.e. national essence, and empiricism on the other. And empiricism in a very empirical sense of, you know, size of containers, temperature, will the plastic melt, will the Dutch drill bits go through the museum door? And I felt you were opposing the two in a very dichotomous kind of way. And it comes in the idea of environment. So you talk about environment, and again, in your talk, it's the temperature, it's, you know, can it go in the container? But when people talk about Hefner or, you know, the artist under steel, they talk about somehow it represents part of Dutch culture. And it seems to me that, you know, what you've just said, it actually hits that much better than talking about the environmentalism. It's a historical conjunction. There is a commitment to a certain kind of modernism, humane modernism, you say, comes straight out of Dutch social democracy. Even what you said right at the end about this, oh, well, we all spent loads of time talking about it and it had to kind of be a consensus. You know, from the outside, that's pure Dutch culture. You know, that kind of, we can't go forward without a consensus across the pillars. I mean, it came out. And so it seems to me that when you say environment, the environment is not just temperature and physicality, but the historical and political conjuncture that didn't get a say too much in your paper, although it did in your answer to the last question. And is not environment actually mean historical conjuncture as well as the environment in the way you used it?
Oh, thank you. Let me think about it for a moment. I suppose that this research and my PhD thesis has been very much a reaction to a historiography that has limited itself to what is the term that you're using? Historical conjuncture, which is a very good term, and I think I'm going to appropriate it. You know, so I think the historiography on Dutch design has explored this aspect quite in depth, I would say. And it has shed light into many dynamics, and you know, it's very interesting. But I noticed two shortcomings with this exclusive focus on the historical conjuncture. One is the kind of exclusive attention to national dynamics. So this historical conjuncture of consensus building, relationship between the government and the public, you know, all of financing, I mean, many of those issues that have indeed been influential in the development in the history of design in this country, for sure are, you know, they are documented, discussed, but these things don't exist in isolation from international dynamics, right? And transnational dynamics. So on the one hand, my study has wanted to say, okay, this is interesting, but let's look at the relationships that these national political dynamics have across borders. Because, you know, what I was mentioning about the Dutch cultural policy changing in the 1980s from a focus on experimentation, creativity, progressiveness of the 1970s towards culture needs to become commercially viable, it needs to pay for itself, it needs to commercialize itself, had very much to do with an answer to or wanting to participate in the international forum differently, right? So that's the thing, that my study in a way wants to complement existing historiography by looking at the transnational dynamics. That's one. And the other thing is that the empiricist approach of looking at, you know, really mundane aspects such as weight, temperature, sizes of doors. I mean, I was looking at the literal, you know, how do you say, plattegrond, the you know, of buildings and so on, is because this is also something that has not been paid attention to at all. So when I was talking, for example, to the curators about this exhibition that I mentioned was the precursor that put those drills and boats and planes and metros and trains in the gardens of the exhibition. Why was it in the garden? Why was it not inside? I mean, it creates also a sort of scale, right, or ranking between art inside and design outside. The kind of physical limitations never come into play. While when I look at the archives with, you know, notes and discussions, it's all about this. So I feel that it's not so much about creating a dichotomy, perhaps as I have done too strongly in this in this presentation, but it is about wanting to complement two kind of blind spots in historiography of design in the Netherlands. I will think about how to include this intention in a way of complementation rather than creating dichotomies in future discussions of my work. So thank you. Okay. I hope this answers your, I don't know, do I?
Yeah, very much. I do think, I didn't mean national focus, it should be national focus, conjuncture, but I was thinking of Bandung. What was the Bandung conference in 65 or 67? You know, and when your exhibition was, yours, the exhibition was 73. So very close to Bandung, third world, real decolonization, and of course, Dutch Indonesia was a Dutch colony and things. So these things are part of it. So what's the Dutch public service doing in Indonesia? With, it's not just a design exhibit, it's also, you know, from its ex-colonial power, but also post-Bandung. So anyway, but yes, but I do think the empirical thing is really interesting. I didn't mean to say you shouldn't do that at all. It's really interesting because it does make you think about, yeah, why the train isn't inside. So thanks for that, that was good. Yeah.
Have we got time for one more question?
I have one more question.
Sure.
Hello, I'm Eric Champion. I was originally an architectural historian, so I have a slightly different perspective. My first master's was on organic notions of organic in architecture, psychological modernism movement in Scandinavia. And I've always had a problem with terms. And I was wondering, and correct me if I'm wrong and I missed something, but transnational to me implies across and between. This is my first question, I've got two actually. Was there a complete reciprocality in terms of Indonesian notions of humane modernism? Or was it really from the Dutch to Indonesia?
Thank you for this question. The way that I focus on the transnational has been to look at, to take on the one hand, the kind of state focus, international cultural policy as taking that as international, as a discussion and communication between states, right? So taking that as a context, as a delimitation of my research. And from that, trying to see what are elements that kind of escape or leak from or are not contained by the international. And where there's, I don't know, reciprocity, I had not thought of, but basically non-state actors across borders. And I focused on then therefore materiality. So precisely, you know, looking at how the materials of design and of places and spaces interact towards enabling or disenabling certain ideas and things to be thought of, discussed, transported, viewed as Dutch design. So so my way out, in a way, of staying within kind of the sanctioned actors that have been, you know, viewed as being important, or, you know, so the way that I try to look at the transnational construction of design has been through this focus on materiality and the interaction with environments outside of the Netherlands. There are different, I mean, for sure there are different ways, and there have been different kind of quality, right, of to trace transnational connections, but that has been how I have approached this term or this concept.
I guess, at least to my second question, I find English very imprecise. So transnational, transcultural, there doesn't seem to be a specific way in talking about the directionality or the non-directionality of it, which was my question. But my second question is towards humane modernity. So the modern designers, the architects, etc., of our house, they saw humanity built into modernity, regardless of whether they're right or not. And I'm wondering if you're interested in how the Indonesian curators and public saw this notion of the humane from their point of view, if there are any distinctions.
Well, there were no Indonesian curators involved in this exhibition, right? So it was very much a Dutch curated exhibition that was literally, you know, transported from one place to place. And the challenge was, how could this exhibition maintain its identity and adapt to different environments? So that was the balance. I have tried to gain, you know, to do research and to gain insights into in not just Indonesian, but also Indonesian perspectives and on this exhibition in particular. But I have not, I mean, I this was a dead end in the research. So in other places or for other exhibitions, there the governments here, the government archives also contain, how do you say, reviews and discussions of the exhibition abroad, but not in this case. So what I do know is that in relation to this exhibition, there were also some attempts at creating exchanges in design teachers. So teachers coming from the Netherlands, for sure, to Indonesia. So Dunbar was also going to Indonesia to teach his version of humane modernism. But I have not seen anything about a reciprocal or the Indonesian perspective on this.
Thank you.
Thanks. I think we might be close to the end of the session. Yeah, so I think we'll wrap up there. I've got a few things I want to ask you, but I'll save that for later. So Joana, thanks so much. That was really fascinating. Really appreciate your time today. So thanks for presenting.
Well, thank you very much for having me. And yes, it was a pleasure. Thank you. Thank you for the questions also.
Cool.